Catch a falling star and put it in your pocket. Never let it fade away. Catch a falling star and put it in your pocket. Save it for a rainy day. For when your troubles start multiplying, and they just might, it's easy to forget them without trying. With just a pocket full of starlight, catch a falling star and put it in your pocket. Never let it fade away. Catch a falling star and put it in your pocket. Save it for a rainy day.
Save it for a rainy day.
Save it for a rainy day.
Hal Mitchell, when he started the cruise for what became the 6593rd, had come from the Genetrix program, in which they made, I think they made some 15 successful recoveries of balloons over out of Itazuki.
That test group literally was the high point of my 30 years in the Air Force. Most diversity of jobs, the best people I've ever worked with. And, you know, they say you can never go home, and that's absolutely true, because going back there was a whole different story.
A bit of history here for the old timers. I was on the flight with Ron Tochiki. He was the aircraft commander, and I was his co-pilot on 30th of April, 1974. And this celebrates, can you guess how many recoveries that would have been that we had made up until 1974?
Any training guesses? Or mission?
Huh? No, training, total training.
1,000.
More than that, many thousand, I would imagine. We ended up with 40,000.
Oh, wow.
This was 20,000 in April of 74. 20,000 recoveries.
I got this assignment, and I didn't know what the test group really did at that time. And I guess I don't know if I knew before I got there what they actually were doing or not, but I know it was a special mission, and it had to do with the Cold War, something to do with defense.
Yeah, we used to say we were supporting classified Western test range activities, remember?
Yes.
I was ferrying an airplane back from it was depot maintenance, and we had a mission in 2 or 3 days. They said, okay, get the airplane back. All right. So we're flying over the Sierras, and all of a sudden we get a prop flux on one of the engines out of limits. So we shut down the engine. The nav is saying, hey, Reno's the closest airport. And, you know, we probably need to get to McClellan. It's not that much farther, you know, and they've got some maintenance there. And so we landed at McClellan, called back to the mission control, said, hey, you know, here's the situation. And about an hour later, I got a phone call, said, be ready to go tomorrow morning. Well, they had made arrangements to go to a rescue aircraft that was sitting alert from the rescue wing or rescue squadron over there at McClellan at the time, pulled an engine off it, put it in ours, ran it up all night. We were ready to go the next morning, got it back in time for the mission. And I think this was still when we were flying 8 airplanes for Mark 8 missions. So, you know, they needed that airplane to complete the, at least to have a spare for whatever reason. Yeah. But it shows the kind of the criticality of the mission and what we're able to do.
The other thing was, we were aware that there were Russian ships, Russian aircraft in the vicinity, that somehow through their intel, they knew sort of what we were doing. That was about as much as I knew that made it as important as it was.
My first flight with the test group was as a left rigger. And I learned that that's the most dangerous and difficult job in the test group. Our mission was critical to the security of our country. We had a priority that meant we could get almost anything at any time. We had an assignment to deploy to Okinawa to recover satellites coming out of Vietnam. So I went out to Okinawa to sort of coordinate it. But before I went, I asked our support guy in the Pentagon to send a message, asking them to send a message to Okinawa that we're requesting support. And I got out to Okinawa and went in to see the base commander, and he had the message, and the message said, essentially, give them whatever they want. And I told him, I said, hey, according to this message, Colonel or General, if I asked for your staff car, I could get it. And he said, where do you want it?
The recovery box was so large that we had to get permission from Washington, D.C., because we essentially shut down all the flights between Japan and Hawaii for 15 minutes. And I remember I was on the phone with the local FAA guys telling them, you know, we needed this box for the mission. And he said, well, you can't do that. And I said, well, who can? He said, rolled off some position or name. And I said, thank you very much. And I called back East Coast and they made it happen. And what was interesting was the very bottom of the last recovery was covered by a guy that was in the Halikoa getting ready to ship out. His tour was over. They brought him onto the base. They gave him one shot, practice, and he's the guy that caught it.
Wow.
You know, speaking of airspace and the large amount that we reserve for mission day, typically we get a call from the STC, Satellite Test Center, giving us a normal release. Well, Marv Fujii, the navigator, was working that day. And they called him and they said, well, we got a briefing tomorrow. We're going to go to recovery. And of course, at that time, normally we'd put out a recording on the one little codaphone we had in the recovery control center. Normal forces are released.
I'm released.
Yes. Tuesday, May the 16th. Well, this night we put, well, the briefing time is 0400 in the morning. We'll see you then. And that was working well. And Marv was still in a recovery control center and gets a call from some general. And I have no idea who that general is, but he says, hey, son, I'm taking some fighters and some tankers to South Korea tomorrow. And you got my airspace blocked up. You can't do that shit. He said, well, I'm sorry, sir. You know, we have a mission plan. He said, you got a large block airspace. You don't need all that airspace. I said, sir, I'm sorry. You can't, you know, it's restricted airspace. You and the airliners can't fly through there. And he went around and around with Marv, and he said, who can I talk to? And he said, you're talking to him, sir. So he had to tell the general, sorry, general, you can't take your fighters to South Korea tomorrow. So Marv won that battle.
We most got anything we wanted.
Yeah, well, the best example I have, and I've probably you've probably heard this from me, at least a couple of you have, but once when I was number four, number five, something like that for a normal mission, and I was about a half hour late on takeoff, and the tower operator knew what was going on that day, knew that we had a mission, so he asked me as I started to taxi out, he said, "Do you want to exercise your Brickbat 01 authorities, and I can get you expedited taxi?" I said, yes, please. He turns back. The next call is to Air Force 2, Spiro Agnew. Hold your position. And we talk to our C-130 in front of the vice president. And I'll bet you those guys are saying, who the hell are those people?
There was a lot of sputtering going on in that cocktail, I'll bet.
Yeah, I'll bet. I had an opportunity a long time ago as a lieutenant to sit at the knees of some pretty influential general officers and colonels that had been World War II and Korea War and all that. And I recall one of them, Kenny Schultz, General Schultz. At the time, he was the vice commander at Space Division. But we had a club there then at Space Division. And he used to like to go to the club, and he'd always mingle with the lieutenants, and he'd start telling war stories. He'd ask them this, and he'd pose questions about how, you know, leadership questions. And one time he posed the question. He said, "Okay, so if you're talking about a sports team and maybe it's basketball, who's the most important player on the team. You know, everybody, you know, trying to think, well, who would it be, the center? Would it be the, you know, he said, you don't understand. He says, the most important person on the team is the guy with the ball in his hands at the time. And it passed. So from that point on, I always thought, you know, the guy that we ought to pay attention to is whoever is the most important person on the team at that point in time. Could be the aft right rigger, could be the winch operator, could be the nav, could be, you know, whoever it was. And I think the test group of all the assignments that I had in 31 years in the Air Force, the test group was the greatest organization that I ever encountered that operated on that premise. I have been worried over the years that we've never had an accurate or complete history of all the rescue missions, and so this is part of the act to try to pull that together, and to get to the personal accounts while we can. You know, none of us are getting any younger, I don't think. And as we started on this endeavor to do oral histories, I realized it's a whole hell of a lot easier than trying to write the history. You don't have to worry about dotting the I's. You don't have to worry about crossing the T's, punctuation, any of that crap. You just let people talk what they want to say, what they want to say in their personal collections. And I think that's wonderful. We'll have we'll end up with many, many hours of these oral interviews, Zoom sessions recorded. And if somebody at some point in time wants to take the effort and go through them all and make a pretty book out of it, they can. But we're not up to that.
Catch a falling star and put it in your pocket. Never let it fade away.
Never let it fade away.
Catch a falling star and put it in your pocket. Save it for a rainy day.
Save it for a rainy day.
For love may come and tap you on the shoulder some starless night. And just in case you feel you want to hold her, you'll have a pocket full of starlight.
Pocket full of starlight.
Catch a falling star and put it in your pocket. Never let it fade away.
Never let it fade away.
Catch a falling star and put it in your pocket. Save it for a rainy day. For when your troubles start multiplying, and they just might, it's easy to forget them without trying. With just a pocket full of starlight, catch a falling star and put it in your pocket. Never let it fade.
I can't remember when they were. I had two successful and one tear through.
Yeah.
Which was recovered by our Navy.
Right.
And the helicopter guys.
Yeah. Right.
Then we started training for the Mark 8s, and then I had my first Mark 8 mission was the tear through. The cone and the parachute was damaged pretty bad. And I got a pole hit, and it tore through. And then Tom Sumner let me stay number one, and so I got a whack at the next one, and that was successful. On the next mission, we were encouraged to try the first pass pretty high, at a pretty high altitude. And that's when the true airspeeds were much higher. Everything was happening faster.
Yeah.
And particularly with a chute that was dancing around, it was tough.
Yeah.
And so I waited and waited and waited. And I don't think I made my first pass till about 12,000 feet. And whoever was on, and I think the mission commander was with me that time, but anyway, whoever it was getting a little nervous about me waiting. I said, man, this thing is going to be steady as a rock down here. And I said, that first pass is going to be good and not to worry. And it worked out.
I went inbound, like you said, I went inbound right at 15. And well, the parachute did me a favor. On the first run, I got to see if I get this right. That was the second run. The first run, it just kind of collapsed and dropped away from me. The second time, I turned right back in, you know, Jack Hall was airborne commander. I said, turn inbound, huh? Nobody else was in a better position than me. And when I went in that time, the cone just dropped over to the side, and the parachute took on the appearance of a wing, and it flew that way. I said, okay, let it go. Came back around, and the last time I was coming, everything was looking real good until all of a sudden it folded up again and looked like it was dropping away again. And I pulled off all the power and did one of these things, you know.
Oh, geez.
The hook went in the top of the cone and caught one of those lines, just happened to be headed in the right direction. And that Bedwell called it the immaculate recovery.
I got there from Vietnam in 1971 and left in 1975. I was only with JC-130s, and my crew position was as a pilot. 52 years ago, when I arrived at Hickam, I'm sure I was introduced into training, ground training or whatever, immediately. I don't recall how long of training period it was. Obviously, at that point, I was, I think, a first lieutenant, and so it was as a co-pilot. And I think I was your co-pilot at a number of missions.
Yep.
So I really don't know how quickly. I mean, I didn't sit around waiting in line to get training. I think I immediately got whatever kind of course that was given. I'm sure I got it immediately. I can't recall how many I was in the right seat for. I was in the left seat for only two, one Mark V, one Mark VIII. Is that on my Mark VIII, on final inbound, everything was going well. I had the trim set on the airplane that I knew was good. And probably 10 seconds out, the parachute started moving. I put in full left rudder, and it went right down the center. But it was, you know, that judgment thing within 10 seconds, how much do I do it all? Do I pull off? And I just decided to stick with it, put in full rudder, and it probably was a zero.
The interesting things was I arrived in the test group in end of November 1971 as a inexperienced co-pilot. I had actually been at Clark, but only for 6 months. I had a total of 520 hours flying time when I arrived at the test group, and seemed to be a surprise to everybody, because when I tried to check in at the admin section, they had no idea who I was or where I was coming from. I had to show them my orders and before they believed anything. And Don, you may remember this, I think you were in scheduling at the time, but at that time things were a little chaotic as Vietnam was winding down and the personnel system hadn't caught up much. So I spent a lot of time as a co-pilot before I got enough hours to be upgraded to a recovery aircraft commander. And I only made one recovery, which would have been in the summer of 75, you know, maybe June, probably July 75 timeframe. And but I was a co-pilot on a whole lot of recovery missions for 3.5 years, I guess. And it was kind of interesting, because by the time I got into the program, I had watched a few hundred parachutes go underneath airplanes and had a pretty good idea of how to make recoveries at that point. So it seemed pretty straightforward. But I know, you know, some of the, you know, a lot of people that came to the test group were instructor pilots or flight examiners, you know, in previous assignments, and sometimes had difficulty making that transition because you did some things that weren't automatic in terms of controlling the airplane from the way you're used to doing it.
And Jarve Adams took me under his wing, and he taught me recoveries. He gave me my first recoveries. And my first job was to make 50 recoveries on a new chute manufacturer to validate that the chutes would work consistently. I've forgotten the name of the company now. It was not Pioneer. It was some other not well-known parachute company. Anyway, so my first job was make recoveries. And Jarve Adams criticized me. He said, you know, we need more pole hits and you're hitting down the middle. It was just natural for me to do it that way. And he said, we need more pole hits to that because we need to see the weaknesses on this parachute.
I wish I had to learn
how to make pole hits. then he had me do tandem recoveries. And then he had me fly with him. And we started doing ground station pickups in front of on the flyby line in front of the tower at Edwards. Because we picked the things like the prime start program when we got that shape. And later on, when we got anytime we got an oddball package, we had to develop a harness. And Bob Counts, our both navigator and engineer, Bob Counts, was good at figuring out a rig that would put something that was in trail stay stable. So Bob Counts would work to try to develop, and we would make ground station pickups. And if it flopped around in the air because it was not oriented right in trail, after we picked it up off the ground, we would just cut it and pick it up and try the harness a different way. And so with trial and error, we developed the harnesses for the prime start program. And later for the D-21, the MD-21 supersonic drone program also. So I had some very early training that nobody else got.
Well, I had one. I was number one for a Mark V recovery. And I don't know if you recall, but it had some serious software perturbations. And aside from the normal accuracy that they had where it would come down, they quite frankly didn't know. I mean, they knew a general area, and they kind of drew up three primary pips
right.
of where they thought it would come down, depending on how the malfunction unwound. And they let me, being number one, make a choice. And I did. And it didn't come down in mine. It was, I can't remember who did recover it, but that was my one time as number one for Mark V. Pretty exciting time, you know.
I don't 1982 to 1986, just left just before the final shutdown. And as a nav, I was fortunate to basically get certified in all the missions. You know, Iraq is Iraq and a refueler, but as a nav, I got to refuel helicopters. I got to do a catch. I was fortunate to wind up in the planning section at one point. So I got to plan missions. I got to do the weather bird. Got a real, I think, 360 experience out of it. And in fact, my last job there, I was the deputy to Denny Laws in the recovery support branch. So I was down there working with all the enlisted crews, which was a privilege. There, in the Philippines, of course, you do a lot of overwater, but it's usually linear. You know, I think the first time I was the only nav on a C-130, I flew from the Philippines to Wake Island starting at 9 o'clock on a Friday night. So that was more water than I'd probably seen in my whole life in one flight. But it was linear and it was celestial, et cetera. When you, at the test crew, as a nav, you know, as you know, we're out there flying those IUD kind of patterns out there. And it was, if you couldn't dead reckon your butt off, you were going to get lost in a hurry. There was not going to be a nav aid to help you. It wasn't a whole lot of time to do much in the way of celestial. Had to learn LORAN. But it was your primary, frankly, was you were checking your dead reckoning against everything else. And I've had a mission or two where if you didn't dead reckon, you were lost.
Yeah.
So I would say that was, in addition to the really practicing and finessing that skill, you really had to learn to trust your judgment. In the Philippines, it wasn't at war. You were always in training. Well, this was the real deal.
It's the real deal.
Yeah.
I mean, the interesting thing was in the 71, 72, 73 timeframe, we were in double mission mode a couple of times. You know, I mean, right. You know, that's pretty intensive load.
Yeah. In fact, that was when Bill Quinn decided that we didn't have enough racks and we needed to do more training. And so when I was scheduling, I recall being directed to increase the number of recoveries and recovery sorties by a mere 100% in 1 week. And we did, by God, and we did really well with it.
Well, and then we also had the fuel shortage. We had to cut back on on using fuel cut back flying hours, and we still had to figure out how to maintain proficiency, because as they cut back our flying time, all of a sudden the scores, if you remember that, the scores started going up, and it was fairly noticeable. Yeah. Just stick it, we were doing the same number of recoveries it always, by just the stick and rudder time differences. Yeah. I think, as I remember. Yeah. Right, so it's kind of interesting.
I'm Pete Larson. I yeah. remember when we were in rescue mode, just what an incredible maintenance officer he was. No matter what came up, he'd go, how many airplanes do you need? You know, I've got six available. And so the question would, the statement would be, we need eight. And Pete says, then you're going to get eight. And that was his approach to everything we ever did. I mean, he was just amazing.
And I was unaware of it. And he said, you're going to Hickam. Satellite recovery, you'll never believe what you're going to be doing. So from that point on, I found out later, he's the one that actually helped get me the assignment. And went to several schools before arriving at Hickam. You know, of course, we had to do the altitude chamber and water survival, all that typical stuff for flying over water a lot. Then I arrive at Hickam, and man, they hit you fast. You started training as soon as you could get up in the air. And as a rigger, one of the first things they would do is put you on a cable and have you walk back to the back edge of the ramp at 10,000 feet.
The last step, huh?
Have you look over the last step, and had two guys wash out that same day because they weren't walking back there.
Yeah, that was a pretty brutal but pretty straightforward test, right?
Well, it was a straightforward test. You had to be able to, I had a cable on. I wasn't going anywhere. And then they started you into several months of training, because as a rigger, you had to be able to work five or six different positions. And they would always start you off as the forward right, who had the least amount of responsibilities. You'd train, you'd learn your checklist. And then when they thought you were ready, they moved you over to forward left, which got the level wind controls, the control of the winding of the winch as the line came back on board. The two forward riggers on the Mark 8 or heavies would throw the doghouses.
Put the doghouses over the cable.
The doghouses would cover the cable so that when you did have one snap, it didn't do near the damage that it could do. Then they moved you to the aft right. And that was the aft right actually deployed the loop and the hooks. And that was a very good training, because if you didn't put the hooks out right, they would come right back in at you. Then you progressed, and the best position to me was the aft left. The aft left was kind of the rigger in charge under the winch, that he controlled the movement, the calls. He made a lot of the calls to the pilot to keep them informed on parachute position relative to the horizon. And it was a real knack to get that one down back there. Like when you had a hook end up in the beaver tail, or you had lines end up hung up in the stab, and you have to decide whether to try to bring it in or cut them loose. At that point in time, nobody else could come past the edge of the ramp. So aft left was kind of final decision on a lot of stuff. He was eyes and ears. And then from aft left, your next progression was to become a winch operator. In 1984, I was out doing a refueling, and we went up pressurized. Coming down, I ruptured a sinus. So I was done. My recovery days were done.
Yeah. Yeah, we all suffered some kind of sinus issues. It wasn't unusual when we were flying
when we were flying unpressurized, Tom, that you had guys with either sinus blocks, ear blocks, or both, and occasionally it got pretty
well. Pretty severe. I'll say something. You remember Dr. Tamara, don't you?
Yeah.
He was our flight surgeon. He told a bunch of us one time that we really have no idea what the type of flying you guys do on a daily basis is going to do to you in 25 years. We go up, altitude, pressurize, depressurize, and come down. And we might do that 4 or 5 times a day. And just the difference in pressure changes throughout the day, I don't know anybody that didn't carry a small bottle of Afrin with them.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah, we did that.
Because you could go up clear as a bell and, you know, it would change during the day.
And that's, I remember
on that back edge of that ramp.
And I remember taking a long time coming back home when we had somebody with a severe block where we tried to get, you know, the Afrin into them and then come down gradually instead of in a hurry. Yeah. We had a lot of issues with that. I recall that.
Well, we had one or two cases of mild bends. And I was actually working forward right on that day. And we got the doghouses down. Everything was going good. And you know, you get the inbound hot, and you get the 10 seconds. Well, when you're up that by the winch up there, you try to make yourself as low profile as possible for contact. You actually make yourself a part of the aircraft. And when that cable blew, there was just didn't sound like a normal recovery, and the payout just didn't happen, and pop. And there was filled like a cloud. And I remember getting a couple pieces of doghouse in the side. Nothing that hurt me bad, but it hit pretty damn hard. And we lost one of the hydraulic systems because the cable took out, I think it was the booster. And we immediately, once we got past that, we went into, you know, emergency procedures. You know, we lived them, we ate them, we drank them. We went straight into emergency procedures. And we jettisoned the poles. And we were lucky we were able to get the winch back into position. And we went home.
I was on the C-130 that they went out to the warning area and they hit the poles and the poles snapped off and went up into the control surfaces. And we all had to put our poopy suits on and they finally were able to get the controls, the airplane under control. I can remember being on the flight deck. They went through the test the checklist and they touched the throttles and the throttles just fell forward, which means that all of the cables had been cut. Two of them, luckily we had opposing engines, one on either wing.
Oh wow.
And they were able to use differential power to be able to arrest the descent, and we went down to about 4,000, something like that. And then took it in and they cleared Honolulu for us and we landed and pulled off into the grass and dug a big furrow in the grass and climbed out of the airplane.
Remember the rag that we had, the jersey rag that went from flight to flight? There was a plaque on there where your number for your recovery.
Well, that was we had the rag and then we had the cherry hook.
The cherry hook. Yeah. I was 69 on that.
Ah.
For what that's worth, I remember that I was 69 on the cherry hook.
So, Tom, what we're talking about is we had in addition to the rag was just a bunch of knotted up old parachutes and lines that went to whoever splashed the most recent guy that had a tear through. And he had to, and that adorned that flight's door until somebody else made a tear through. And then we had a thing called the cherry hook, and it was kind of obscene, as you might, but it was given to whoever got a recovery for the first time.
As I got the rag on my check ride with Randy Chang.
Oh,
and so I had to go out and do another recovery. But they gave me the rag, and it hung in the commander's office for the entire period of time that the test group remained until we took the flag down, until we retired the test group.
The recovery that I didn't make, this was given to me when we left, and May 79 to May 85, I was a natural homesteader. Man, I loved Hawaii. And so all it says is Major William J. Drasky, and referencing my recovery or non-recovery, it says, always a bridesmaid, never a bride.
Yep, the NAVs were in charge.
They were overall in charge of the test group personnel on the ship.
Well, they kind of told the ship where to go to.
Yeah, in both the literally and the figuratively.
Right.
You mentioned George Kakuna.
Yeah.
During your previous conversation. And that guy was just a fantastic Hawaiian. He was really my best friend over there. He was outstanding. It's too bad he passed.
Well, that man was a phenomenal pilot. I mean, he could do things with a helicopter that even, you know, people only dream about. And the other thing, he was easygoing, but, you know, you knew where the limits were exactly. But right. Fun thing was flying around. If you're off island, he had so much in his head. He would say, well, up here, this valley here, you know, I had my great grandfather, that's where they put his bones and stuff. And everywhere we went on the Big Island one time, and it was nothing but an open history book. And that guy had so much Hawaiiana in his head that, you know, I really wish that he had written that stuff down, because I think a lot of that stuff gets lost as the years go on.
Yeah.
I remember the one thing he told me, I was talking about going out to sea. When I first got there, he was taking me out. And, you know, I came out of jets. So, you know, I'd gone through the helicopter school and that was it. And I said, boy, there's a lot of water out here. I said, you know, we really go out 400, 500, 600 miles. He said, how far can you swim? I said, I don't know, about a mile. And he said, so anything over a mile, it really doesn't matter, does it?
I remember the first time I met George. I had just gotten the test group and walked in to meet him. And I want to say it was you, Roger, that you were the DO at the time for the helicopter group. And then I walked in, I was talking to you, and he goes, yeah, you're going to get along great with George. He really likes Howleys. I had never even heard the term. I said, Howleys. About this time, George walked in behind me and goes, Howleys, good for lunch. I said, okay, I know what this unit's going to be like. And it was great every time. But Mike, you were right about how he could fly. I've never seen anybody else put an aircraft in a hover at 50 feet over the water and take his hands off the controls and the aircraft just sit there. And George could do that. He knew how to trim that airplane. It just would sit there. I worked so hard and he'd just make it look so easy.
The main rescue, there were two actually. One was a planned rescue of a PJ we were working with out in the ocean, just pointing around, and suddenly we saw that he was in trouble. He was chased by sharks. They had cornered him. And so we whipped in there and picked him up, and his fin was actually bit off by one of the sharks. And it was fantastic. We just got him out in time, but that was a planned practice that we were working on, but we didn't realize all the sharks were there.
Was tremendous feat of airmanship and bravery, especially by Don and the PJ on the side of that. That was like a 70-degree slope or something. It was Don's blades were within 5 to 10 feet of hitting the boulders on the side of the mountain there and the rocks and stuff. And, you know, there was no margin for error in that hover. I mean, you had to hold your position exactly, because otherwise you were going to be the next accident. And then the PJ, it was so steep, the PJ had to hold on to parts of the wreckage to even get the people in the Stokes litters. He couldn't stand on that hillside. It was so steep. Wow. And so the fact that he unclipped and stayed down there was just amazing. And
a call from the Coast Guard, and they wanted additional support for a rescue that was a little bit beyond their means. And it was and I can't remember the guy's name, but he was ferrying a 182 retractable, Cessna 182 retractable geared aircraft from California, heading for Australia. And he ran out of gas about 200 or 300 miles off the coast of the Big Island. And he went into the water, and they asked me if we could support that and go out and look for him. And so we did. At the crack of dawn, we were off with, let's see, I think we had one helicopter and one P, 130P model for refueling, because we couldn't do it in one trip from the Big Island. So we got out there, and we were following the ELT signal. There was an ELT signal, and after quite a while, we got there at daylight, and we saw this aircraft sitting in the water with a tail sticking straight up in the air, and floating. And it had been there for quite a few hours. Get over top, no sign of survival, of the survivor, if there was one, the pilot. But we could see a one-person life raft tied up to the wing strut, but no pilot. So I talked to the two PJs that we had on board the helicopter, and I said, jump down there and look inside. Don't go inside, but let me know if the pilot's in there. I said, okay. So they deployed, inspected the wreck, and we hoisted them back up and says, this guy is not there. And so we were thinking, and it was a little bit of a wind, I don't know, 15 knots maybe, and out of the northwest. And we were running low on fuel. We had about a half an hour left. And I talked it over with the aircraft commander and the navigator we had. And I said, you know what the winds were. Let's try to fly for that last 30 minutes before we have to hook up upwind and see if we just might get lucky. And by God, I don't think we were on that track for about 10 minutes. There he was in the water, and we got him. And he'd been in the water for a long time. In the dark and not knowing what was going on, but he also had a personal ELT on his life vest, and I think that's what we were tracking on, because the one on the aircraft I think was dead. I think the battery finally drained out on that thing, but when we saw the visual on the aircraft, we just went to the aircraft and stopped looking at the battery indicator. And otherwise we'd have probably found him sooner. But anyway, we got the guy, and there's a little humor that comes along with that. I asked him if this experience was going to change his attitude about ferry flying to Alaska in little airplanes. He says, oh no, he says, next week I got another trip to make. So, you know, that didn't faze him one bit. But anyway, we had a flight surgeon along, and he checked him out. He was all right. So on the way back, the flight surgeon and I were sitting side by side in the two jump seats, and we dozed off. And the next morning, down in the op center near the scheduling office was a sign-up sheet with this blown-up picture of me and the flight surgeon, you know, and I'm sitting there with my head on my leaning over this way. The flight surgeon is asleep, you know, with his head leaning the other way. We're both, you know, just about that far apart. And it says, under the picture, it says, caption required, you know, make your best shot. And there was a whole bunch of examples, but the one I thought was the best was, and it was selected as the winner, and it was this. Was this as good for you as it was for me?
Well, one afternoon we were flying, and we watched this Twin Beach take off from Honolulu as we were taxiing in at, you know, 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon. He was maybe 100 feet at the end of a 15,000 foot runway. And we thought, oh gosh, he must've lost an engine, or, you know. So then we turned into Hickam and didn't think anything about it. The next morning we're out in warning area 320 and got a call to contact, from mission, our mission ops. It said contact center. Or maybe we got a call from center. I don't remember which it was, but said, hey, there's a light plane that is emergency fuel trying to make it into Maui. Can you guys go up there and cap it? And so we said, sure. And we motored on up there. And it was one of the days where we had one of our mission photographers on board. And we got there in time. The guy had lost, he'd run out of fuel. And he was trying to glide to make it to Maui. He was a couple miles short, did a pretty good landing in the ocean. And our photographer got it, you know, had a movie of it. And he got out on his wing, and we circled around and did our normal little Pokeye Bay thing, dropped the life raft, and just about, it was a perfect, perfect drop, just about knocked him off the wing. Yeah, it was that close. And by that time, there was a Coast Guard chopper on the way, so we went back and continued our training. But, it was one of those things where he'd gone out there and circled around Ocean Station, where he thought Ocean Station November would be, circled around for an hour, hour and a half, and then turned back into the wind to try and make it back to Hawaii. And if he just kept going eastward, he would have run into a runway somewhere, but chose not to do that.
My first catch, the first Corona catch, was in September of 66, and I'd only been there a little over a year at that point in time. As far as the two special missions go, the prime mission, which came up in the early part of, or the late part of 66 and the early part of 67, there were going to be four. There were supposed to be four vehicles that were flown, and they were to be recovered. The first one, the chute didn't really open, and so it went to the bottom. And the second one, when they flew past the system on the first pass, they noticed that a couple of the risers weren't properly configured, and so they didn't want an attempt to make a recovery, so that one went in the water. The third one, which is the one that we ended up catching, Al Kaiser was designated as number one for that mission. Joe Modica was dedicated as number two. And Jack Winning was supposed to be Jack Winning was supposed to be number one. But he had a cruise booked with his wife for the week that they did the launch. So Kaiser moved up to one, Modica moved up to two, and I filled in at three. And we all deployed to Canton Island for a couple of days to get ready. And then we flew off the coast of, we flew down range from Kwajalein. And they fired the rocket and the lifting body. It was a successful launch and a successful burn to bring it back into the atmosphere, and a good shoot. And it was that shoot that had the white cone on top. So Kaiser was number one. He found the chute quickly. I found the chute quickly. Modica had gotten a bum steer from his radio operator, so he'd gone off in a different direction. But Al Kaiser had a difficult week the week before we went to Kwajalein. On a couple of his practice, he dragged the bottom of the airplane across the chute, and so he got a little worried about relative position coming in on the final pass. And so when the active system came in, he made one pass and was too high, came around and made a second pass and was too high. And as soon as he made the second pass, I declared, I got it. And so we got it on the first pass, got it in trail. So I sent you a picture.
Yep.
With me standing beside the prime vehicle there in the museum. The mission that where I ended up catching the D-21 slab, the package coming out of the D-21, was a little bit northwest of Kauai. It was on a Sunday. It must be the only time they could fly that thing was on the range. It was the weekend when nobody else was out there. But it was a day that had a number of cells popping up around it. Almost kind of like the picture, the Air Force Art Collection picture with the 119 catching the first corona and with the big black cloud in the background. So he said, well, you know, you train, you fight like you train, you train like you fight. So why not? So it worked out. It worked out pretty well. And things went pretty smoothly on that one.
So anyway, and then I trained. Dick Schofield was the fourth guy. Kaiser Schofield. So I flew the first one, and we flew into Kwajalein. A guy who later made recoveries was my co-pilot for that. I can talk to that later. Anyway, we flew into Kwajalein, got clearance into Iniwetok, and then we took off about 4 o'clock in the morning for the first one. And we never saw hide nor hair of it. And we had a air rescue 130 with us to check the weather ahead of us. And I never have forgotten Joe Modica had managed to get some green paint, watercolor paint, got it somewhere at Iniwetok, and they painted the nose of the air rescue service, the radome on the air rescue service C-130 green. And later, the base commander was a lieutenant colonel who I later knew at Vandenberg, and he made us go out and wash the green paint off the rescue. Bruce Rao was I remember the AC of that rescue airplane that was with us. But anyway, we never saw hide nor hair of the first one, so I had designated myself to be the number one spot for the first one. So Jack Winning was the other pilot I hadn't mentioned yet. The pilots were Gurney, Winning, Kaiser, Modica, and Schofield. And for the next mission, it came down, but it didn't disreef. It was the lifting body was supposed to disreef from, the reefing cutters hadn't cut it. It was in wrong position. So I made look see. Next mission, I had Winning in number one position. I flew two, and I looked at it when it came down, and I said, the reefing cutters haven't cut. Mike Meyer, Colonel Meyer, our group commander at the time, was in the command center at the time, and the program office wanted to try it anyway, but we never tested it without the reefing cutters letting go. So he said, no, we're not going to do that. So I had to let it splash. So they, in real time, they told us we had to let it splash. So we let it splash, and we had tested it by floating it at Magoo when I was at Edwards earlier. Iggy Janassi was the program manager down in L.A. for that. The captain, he was the guy that we coordinated with for all the testing we did. Anyway, Iggy Janassi, we told him that feathering gear that you tested at Magoo, it'll never work in the open ocean because it's not strong enough for the kind of waves they'll see in the open ocean. Well, that's what happened. It wasn't strong enough, so it let go. And the thing sank before the boat was in sight. They had a ship out there also. The ship was inside the rain ship, but it couldn't get there in time, and it sank. And I watched it disappear. And so the second one, we thought we had came in, but we didn't catch it. The third one, I was busy chasing D-21s. Anyhow, from there to Howard Air Force Base in Panama, and they launched the balloons from Albrook across the canal in the city, near the city, Albrook, and we flew out of Howard. And they would launch the balloon, and we would take off out of Howard before they let the balloon go, and we'd follow it around. And I made a recovery. That's the recovery I made. It something 19,200 feet, right over San Jose. We signaled the ANCASH down with a Motorola set we had that had would tell us that we had TM that would tell Bob Count set that up too. He set up an antenna through the very pistol pit port above the navigator station. Mm-hmm. Had an antenna down to the Motorola set that monitored the TM on the balloon and tell us when it was complete and whatnot. And we also, by dialing numbers, code numbers, you cut the package loose when we were ready to recover. We thought we had it clear, but we cut it loose and it came down into a building thunderstorm, edge of it. And so I started climbing out, and I ended up with a tandem parachute. I knew I didn't have to worry about recovery successes because using two Mark 5Bs 100 feet apart, stacked like that, you had a lot of stretch to damp the shock of the recovery. So even though our limit was 15,000 feet for making recovery, supposedly, I climbed on out trying to get it before it went into the clouds, and I hit it at 19,200 feet. Bob Bounce was the avid. He was the guy that really developed the package for the ash can system.
Ah.
He designed a package and had it. And I went over to the M&M hangar at Edwards, the great big hangar. And Bob Bounce was working in there, fabricating this, getting this thing welded up and to shape. And we originally had a balloon bar about 10 or 12 feet wide with all these bags hanging from it. And the guy came in from Ed Goodfellow, where the Weather Service was located then, came in from Goodfellow. Captain came in and said, can you recover this balloon, this package? And, well, you can't recover that balloon bar. In fact, the bags weren't strong enough to sustain the recovery. So we said, we'll try. So Bob Counts really went to the M&M hangar and draw up a design, had this cage, two blower cage welded up, and we first picked that up off the ground. It was very stable the way he harnessed it. And so that's how the ASCAN program got to the package got developed.
Well, I really enjoyed the two ash cans I got to deploy on. One to Albuquerque, and one was basically down in Corpus Christi.
Uh-huh.
The high altitude balloons were.
Yeah.
I really enjoyed going in on those briefs. It was something new. What they did was they had the gondola was attached to the balloon, and once they were done, it separated and would deploy the chute, very similar to the satellites then.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and it was a basic Mark 5 chute, right?
The one I got was a Mark 8 chute.
Oh, really?
Yes, because this gondola, it barely fit in the back.
No, I can't imagine another unit being more cohesive than ours. Basically, because we were the only outfit in the world that did that. It wasn't like going from one airlift squadron or one fighter squadron to another. The cohesiveness between the back end guys, the front end, the navigators. It was just that working together with the winch operators, the EDF operators, the guys on the poles in the back. It just felt like it was the most special mission in the world. And, I didn't know the entire time I was there who was listening in the Pentagon for our missions.
It set for me a standard of expectation that I spent the rest of my career trying to instill in every unit that I either was part of or commanded. Never quite got there, but at least I knew what the standard, the high standard of expectation was. And the joy, frankly, of being involved in a unit that had such a strong sense of itself and all the people in it, that was a goal that I tried to reach, never could, because test group was unique, but it was a standard of excellence and expectation that I treasure to this day.
And then when it came time for me to leave, they PCS'd me 9 miles to Hickam. I mean, they started the clock all over, gave me another cluster for the ribbon, and I went 9 miles, literally. And I took over the 15th OSS and eventually left as the vice wing commander of Hickam. But we were there in the golden years. I mean, the base was never the same. They say you can never go home. And that was absolutely true. You know, the heart of Hickam was the 6594th test group. And that ramp was awful empty out there. And, you know, the whole complexion of the base was different.
You know? Remember General Henry used to come out and do the command calls. And he always used to say, "You guys have so much talent that I don't want to lose you. If you want assignment, come up and see me."
Anytime somebody needed a crew to go somewhere or do something, I remember people just volunteering left and right. So
yeah,
if you got to go on a rescue, that was pretty cool. Went out on a mission, that was even better. And to be lead was the best.
Yeah. I had the good fortune of working with all these miracle workers, Stoney and Paul Marieski, Pat Beecham, Warren Green, Mrs. Lou, Mike Petrosh, who was the head of maintenance, and Larry Fellows, who's the head of operations, both master sergeants. Really good people. And they really made the mission. Like I told Paul today, he said I was a good boss. I said, it's you can do anything when you have great people to boss, because they do it for you, you know.
When I got there, I was coming from Alaska, and I was renting a place in the Marco Polo up on the 14th floor that had this view of Alawai Canal and Honolulu City Lights. And I'm finding myself in shorts and flip-flops, and I'm leaning against the railing going, "My God, I think I've died and gone to hell." The assignment itself is just, it was incredible. Ditto to what all the guys said in terms of a camaraderie, the professionalism to it, the satisfaction that we were really doing something. And so much in peacetime military, you know, is just training, training for the reality of when you might actually execute your mission. And we were executing ours all the time.